propose dans ce
During
sujet de traiter
I'd
du lien
like to talk
entre
about the connection
l'activité
between multinational company activities and
the
working conditions of those who manufacture the products which consumers find in the shops. Clothing shops or toy shops or electronic device shops. One criticism made towards globalization over the last decades was the fact that actually we're contributing to workers being exploited in developing countries, and Western country consumers, even those who are concerned by their working conditions, become fully aware of the situation and have any impact on their working conditions. In the 70s and even more in the 90s, large multinational companies have developed strategies to delocalize production so that they can decrease production costs. They sign contracts with factories located in Latin America or Asia. They keep in European or American offices the strong added value activities, research and development, design, product design and administration, but
de ce qui est vendu, par exemple,
a small share of what is being sold by Nike or Apple or Decathlon is actually produced in so-called developed countries. In the United States and in Europe, several social groups, students, trade unions, NGOs, have voiced their concerns regarding the working conditions of people working in Mexico, China, Vietnam or Bangladesh in the factories. The media also got hold of the problem ever since this photograph was published in 1996. An American magazine published this picture of a Pakistani child making football balls for Nike sitting on the ground. Nike became the symbol of multinational companies for whom globalization meant trying to find lower and lower production costs without worrying about the consequences that this might have for those workers who were at the end of the process. The multinational companies are being blamed for having delocalized production in countries where labor law is close to unknown and where workers cannot defend their rights. Now, the situation varies from country to country. In China, for instance, workers have no right to organize themselves outside of the official trade union, and the official trade union is anyway controlled by the local authorities, whereas there are countries where trade unions are free but are still submitted to retaliation from the employers or the public administration. In some factories in some countries, people work for many hours for very low wages. There is child labor or people work in dangerous conditions, as was shown by the disaster of the Rana Plaza in Bangladesh in 2013, where 1,200 workers, men and women working in the textile industry, were killed. Now, the efforts are based on conventions by the International Convention on Working Conditions, and these conditions are imposed on the factories. Thousands of audits are being conducted in companies working for multinational corporations, but unfortunately, the audits had little impact on working conditions. The first limitation of the approach was based on the fact that the social audits are not really reliable. A simple visit of a factory for a few hours does not really allow to show laws being breached and obligations being breached, and also sometimes the factory owner will not refrain from bribing the auditor, and it is sometimes difficult to perform an audit in the outsourcing network of a multinational. The Rana Plaza building had been assessed as being safe several times before it actually collapsed on top of the workers in 2013. Not only do we have a problem to check the situation in factories, but also the conditions that would allow factories to improve working conditions are not met. Purchasing habits from multinational companies have not changed even after they were accused of exploiting workers in the years 2010. The strategy still consists in trying to get the lowest possible prices, which means that the factories and the people working in those factories are submitted to a lot of pressure. It is quite difficult to find reliable and accurate data concerning the sharing of the profit, who gets what share of the profit when a T-shirt or an iPhone is being sold. The data is kept hidden by the companies. But we know that the share given to a worker at the end of the chain is very small, between 0.5 and 3% of the final price at best. This graph, which was published in the magazine The Economist in 2010, shows that the share of the final price of an iPad is 2% for the Chinese worker who actually made the iPad. The little red stripe at the top of the graph, and the share would be approximately the same for an iPhone 6 or a pair of shoes made in Asia. So people are still voicing criticism quite loudly, and campaigns are organized in order to draw awareness from the media and from the consumers. For instance, just before Christmas, to draw awareness on the way toys are being made in Asia. Or here we have a picture in a shopping mall in Hong Kong on the day an Apple store was inaugurated. Are there alternatives to the conduct code and social audit? And is it possible to have a real impact on working conditions in globalized production lines?
One
solution that emerged in the last few years consisted in asking help from outside consultants or private companies to help improve working conditions. In Bangladesh, following the Rana Plaza disaster, an agreement was signed between international trade unions, brands, and the Bangladeshi government in order to improve safety in the buildings where factories are housed. One may welcome this kind of initiative. However, significant improvement will only be achieved on two conditions. First of all, that multinational companies agree to or are obliged to give a higher share of the final price to the factory so that working conditions can be improved, and also that political conditions are met in the developing countries so that workers can, on their own accord, ask for better wages or better working conditions.